You're welcome back to The Breakfast on Plus TV Africa. We apologize for that extended break. We now have our guest, Mr. Nick Agule. Good morning. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning.
Okay.
How are you today?
Fine. How are you doing?
Very well. Thank you so much.
So today on The Breakfast, we're discussing Nigeria's debt profile. I want us to begin, first of all, with statements from the President of the Senate, Ahmed Lawan, about Nigeria and her lack of resources and the fact that, you know, the country is poor. Let's get your thoughts on this. Is that a fact?
Okay, so there are four things that we can analyze in the Senate President's speech. He says Nigeria is poor, and he also says Nigeria does not have resources. The first statement is correct. Nigeria is indeed poor. Nigeria is like a father working in Lagos, earning 10,000 naira per month, and having a family of 10 to feed. There is no way that father can lift his family out of poverty, no matter what he does. Even if that father has zero corruption in his system, that father commits all of the money he earns to look after his family, and the father has all the good intentions for his family, there is nothing that this father can do to lift his family out of poverty because he does not have the money to do it. Nigeria's federal government budget is $35 billion. And when we say $35 billion, the budget is usually not implemented fully. If you get 50% performance in terms of implementation, or even 70%, we're talking about $20 billion. And the government of California, which is a single state in the United States of America, their budget is almost $200 billion for 40 million people. One state, $200 billion. And Nigeria is budgeting $35 billion, of which they are implementing about $20 billion. And then you can say California is buying stuff in dollars. But Nigeria is also spending in dollars. When we import petrol, it's in dollars. When we buy vehicles, it's in dollars. When we buy ammunition for our armed forces, it's in dollars. We buy computers in dollars. We're importing everything. So Nigeria and California are buying from the same market. So you can imagine that a single state has $200 billion to spend for 40 million people, and Nigeria has $35 billion for 200 million people. So on that count, the Senate President is right. Nigeria is very poor.
So, Mr. Agule, I need to ask you about debt servicing. A report by Budget shows that Nigeria spent about 3.34 trillion naira on debt servicing in Nigeria. Where really is this coming from, and how are the figures looking for 2021?
Now, allow me to land my earlier point. I would like to do that before I will now answer your next question.
All right, go ahead.
Yes. I agree with the Senate President that Nigeria is a poor man. He can't look after his family. Let's be honest about that. But I totally disagree with the Senate President when he says Nigeria is resource poor, that we have no resources. That is a fallacy. It shows that the Senate President is living in denial of the endowment that Nigeria has. This is a Senate President that does not even understand the country that he's superintending over. Nigeria is one of the best endowed countries in the whole world. In my line of work, working for international oil and gas companies around the world, I have traveled to nearly 40 countries in the world in my line of work. And I have never seen a country that is as rich as Nigeria in terms of resources. You look at countries like Australia, go to Australia, majority of the land is desert. There's no single desert territory in Nigeria. Every single soil in Nigeria is cultivated. You can cultivate it, and it will grow crops. It will grow tree crops and fruit crops. Nigeria is well endowed with a good climate. In the United Kingdom, where I'm sitting now, there will come a time where we don't see the sun. In the whole day, you won't see the sun. That is during winter. Nigeria has a sun almost 10 to 12 hours every day. That is what crops need to grow. Nigeria has got rivers. Nigeria has got mineral resources on the net. Nigeria has got a population. This population of 200 million we have that we think is a problem, other countries are looking for it. Go to the United States, Canada, Australia, United Kingdom, they are looking for people. We have them. We can unlock value from these things. But we have a government that is lazy. Instead of unlocking value, the government is just busy borrowing. So if I now answer your question, Nigeria is borrowing herself to death. You quoted the figures, and they are correct. Last year, 2020, Nigeria earned $3 trillion, and we spent $3 trillion to pay debt, to service debt. So every other thing that was funded in the budget was borrowing. How can you be borrowing to pay debt? That is financial crisis. And Nigeria can get herself out of this situation by simply opening up the economy for production. I can give this government a few tips. Number one, one of the biggest expenditure items in this government is fuel subsidy. But this government has been in office for 6 years. The government has not touched the refineries. Nigeria has 4 refineries with a combined refining capacity of 450,000 barrels. If this government started work on getting those refineries fixed in their first year in office, maximum by their second or third year in office, Nigeria will be producing enough petrol for herself and even exporting. And so we will not need to spend money to go and be importing petrol and pay subsidies on it. This government is giving lip service to things like agriculture. For proper agriculture to take place, you need to mechanize. You need to look at clear land. If you leave Lagos all the way to Ibadan, to Akure, you should have seen all the land cleared and tractors working to unlock value. Instead, Nigeria is importing food. So these are some of the things. Nigeria does not have electricity. How can you have a country of 200 million people requiring 200,000 megawatts of electricity and you are giving 4,000 megawatts of electricity to that economy? The economy can't be unlocked. So these are the things the Senate president should be dealing with instead of saying we should go and borrow. We have everything going for us.
All right. Two things I want to ask. The first one is with regards our borrowing, because there's the fear that we may never be able to pay back this debt if we continue with the way we're going. And at some point, you know, up to 95% of our budget every year would be to pay back debt. But I want to ask about how we can better, you know, direct the funds that we use, that we borrow. You know, Nigeria keeps claiming that it's borrowing for infrastructure. But what we see is, you know, one or two trains and, you know, a couple of roads here and there. Do you think there are better ways for some of the things that you've mentioned now with agriculture? We've been able to unlock the true potential that Nigeria has, mineral resources. Do you think we can better, you know, redirect our borrowing and where these funds are put into so that we can have like a 5-year, 10-year plan with which, you know, we can now start to reap the benefits of that borrowing? And then also, I want you to speak on taxation. In your write-up, you mentioned taxation and how, you know, Nigeria may need to expand its tax bracket and be able to bring in more people into that tax bracket and, you know, hopefully raise more funds. So quickly share your thoughts on those two.
Thank you very much. If you ask me, Nigeria doesn't even need to be borrowing money to fund infrastructure. We have a market of 200 million people in the world. When investors see 200 million people, they want to go there. So Nigeria should just create the enabling environment for these people to come and invest their money. I love telecom so much, and I will add LNG to it as well. The telecoms companies, MTN and Co., they have invested over $70 billion in Nigeria's economy as of today, and still counting. Nigeria didn't borrow to do that. It only gave way, commercialized the sector, and then investors came in, brought in their money, developed the infrastructure. You and I know that there is a lot of inefficiency in government. So when government borrows money to build infrastructure, you know that that money is going to sink into some loophole somewhere, you know, because government is not a businessman. The role of government should be regulatory, you know. So if you ask me, I would say government should just simply give way. Like we're talking about rail sector. Instead of the government borrowing to fund rail, the government should simply just concession the entire country out to both local and international investors to bring their money, build the rails, put the wagons on top, run those rail lines. With 200 million people paying money, they will recoup their money the same way the MTNs are recouping their money today. Yeah. This is what government needs to do. So when government straddles the economy to pretend over the economy, is a player in the economy, you find out that, in fact, I'll give you an example. There's an article I wrote where I compared the NNPC and the NLNG. These two companies are operating in the same sector, in the oil and gas sector. In fact, the NNPC is a bigger operator because the NNPC is an integrated company, both oil and gas, whereas NLNG is only gas. These two companies are also owned by the federal government of Nigeria. But the difference is that in the case of the NLNG, it is the private sector participant. The company is owned by the federal government and international oil and gas companies who are bringing in their management to run the company. And company is delivering dividends to the Nigerian economy. $18 billion of dividends delivered to Nigeria. The other company, the NNPC, which is also owned by Nigerian, by the federal government of Nigeria, that is being run by the government, is perpetually making losses. That company, between 2018 and 2019, by their own published financial statement, spent 325 billion naira on the four refineries to refine zero barrels of crude oil. 325 billion naira refined zero barrels of crude oil. That is what happens when government is managing business. So if you ask me, the government should not even touch any loan to come and build any infrastructure. Just give way like they did in the NLNG, like they did in telecoms. Let businesses come in and do these things, bringing their money. The money that MTN invested, MTN and Co. invested $70 billion, is standing on Nigerian soil. They cannot come and carry that infrastructure away. And yet, there is no kobo of that on the balance sheet of government as debt. Instead, the telecom sector is contributing more than 10% to the GDP of Nigeria and paying billions in taxes to Nigeria, instead of Nigeria borrowing, spending, and we are not seeing the results.
Mr. Agule, can Nigeria ever stop borrowing? Is that a possibility for our economy?
So let's look at it this way. Every government around the world borrows. I am an accountant. As a chartered accountant, as a finance person, we have what we call the gearing theory. And that gearing theory says that companies that have borrowing on their balance sheet, they do better than companies that don't have borrowing. Because borrowing actually helps you. You know, and one of the reasons why Nigeria's economy is not growing is that the government has not provided the enabling environment for the financial sector to give loans to businesses and to individuals. When people are anonymous, how can you give them a loan when they can just disappear into thin air? So in other places, government has social security numbers that they have given to everybody. That is what Nigeria is trying to do with me. But they have to be aggressive about that. So bottom line is that every company, every government borrows. But Nigeria's situation is different. Nigeria's situation is that we have not got at the point where our borrowing has become too much. Our borrowing is now unserviceable. We are spending all the money we earn. In 2020, Nigeria earned 3 trillion. Yeah? And we use the entire 3 trillion to service debt. If you are even a father or mother, and your entire salary is going to debt servicing, you know you are in problem. You know you are in acute problem. You know you cannot simply borrow any longer. So that is the situation. Debt is good, but Nigeria has got to a point where we can no longer borrow any longer because all of our money is now going to debt servicing. So if I now answer the second question that talks about taxation, around the world, governments are making money through taxation. And government makes money through taxation because government provides the enabling environment for bringing people into the tax bracket. As we're speaking today, if you import a private jet into Nigeria, you are paying zero duty on that private jet. But if you import food, you pay duty. You import a car to drive, you pay duty. You know, so how can government not be taxing the rich instead of taxing the poor? Like when we talk about fuel subsidy, you are taxing the poor to fund the rich. Because go to every big man's home, you see about 6-10 cars parked outside. Those are the guys who are consuming petrol. You are subsidizing them. The poor people in Ajegunle, in Mushin, do they have cars? When they want to go, they go with Molwe. Molwe is using diesel. And you are not subsidizing diesel. So Nigeria is a country that is unique, where they are taxing the poor to fund the rich. Everywhere else in the developed world, they tax the rich heavily to fund the poor. I worked here in the United Kingdom for an international oil and gas company for nearly 10 years. My taxation was 40%. 40% of my pay was going straight into government. And then government is using that money to fund education for everybody. Education is free all the way to high school. So you don't have to be a child of a rich person to go to quality schools. Government is using that money to fund healthcare. Everybody can go to any hospital for free. You know, and so we have billionaires in Nigeria who are not being taxed. The people who are being taxed are the market women. Go to the market, as I'm speaking to you now, this morning, there are people who are busy taxing the market women, collecting money, issuing them all sorts of receipts. And billionaires are bringing in private jets, they are not paying duty on it. Billionaires are living lifestyles that are clearly above the income that they are declaring to government, and government is not chasing after them.
All right, Mr. Guli.
So we have a government that is lazy.
Yeah. And now you've brought that up. That's where I want to go next, because obviously this conversation, you know, expands in so many directions. There's so many places where we're getting it wrong. But I want you to speak with regards the government's economic advisory team. For a long time, we've heard of so many teams headed by the vice president, headed by, you know, Charles Soludo, here and there. They keep coming up with these plans and these committees. You know, to lift 100 million Nigerians out of poverty and whatnot. So what's your assessment of the economic advisory team of the current administration? I'm sure that there's somebody on those teams who knows these things that you've said. I'm sure that there's somebody who understands what needs to be done in order to stop Nigeria from borrowing. They know. There has to be somebody on that team who knows. So what do you think is going wrong with those teams?
I thank you very much for that question. Indeed, Nigeria has a presidential economic advisory council. They met a few weeks ago, issued their report, which we also commented on this program. And I also agree with you that Nigeria has smart people, very intelligent people. So these issues that we're discussing here are not unknown to them. They know these things. But what is required is political will. The political will to be able to take decisions. And you know, I always tell people that one of the key criteria for leadership recruitment should be people who have compassion. If you have compassion over the suffering of the people, you will not be sleeping until you see the people's life is changed. So I don't see so much compassion in the hearts of those who are governing Nigeria today. Because if there is so much compassion in their hearts, there is no way school kids as young as 3 years old will be kidnapped and be held hostage, and government officials are sleeping and waking up and sleeping and waking up, and there is no sense of urgency sense of emergency to try and get those kids back. So what is lacking in Nigeria is the political will. The political will to be able to take these decisions.
Yeah, but is it the lack of political will, or do you, you know, at the stage we start to feel like these things are intentional? It can't continue to be lack of political will. We've spoken about this since 1999 and even earlier. So does it already start to seem like these are intentional? Because the Senate President knows, you know, that it's necessary to leave some of the you know, items off the executive list, and of course let, you know, public-private partnerships to exist. You've made mention of the telecom sector and how that has thrived since those decisions were taken. And so is it lack of political will, or does this start to seem intentional to keep things this way?
Honestly, I mean, I think that way sometimes. I think that way sometimes too, that these guys are basically just being intentional in terms of not being able to deliver good governance to us. Yeah. So because you look at things that are so simple, you know, simple things to do. Why are they not doing it? You know, that kind of thing. Like you talk about electricity. We are flaring gas. Flaring gas. When that gas is what is supposed to be harnessed and electricity generated. But because they have generators that are giving them electricity, is that why they don't care? You know, there's so many, it's mind-boggling what is happening. So I will not disagree with you to even think that it could be intentional. But the question is that why? Why would you intentionally want to visit suffering on your people? Why? Because in Nigeria, I can give you example. Let me give you something like domestic gas. In the UK, where I am now, we don't buy gas in cylinders. Okay? Gas is piped to every individual home in the same way as electricity is connected, water is connected. Nigeria stops flaring gas. The gas that were flaring in the Niger Delta, all over that place. If we stop flaring that gas, harness that gas, convert it, and begin the project of piping that gas in every home in Nigeria. Do you know the number of jobs that will be created to construct that? Start with places like Lekki. Go to Lekki and run pipes to connect gas to every home. Do you know how many jobs, construction jobs, that will be created? Do you know how many jobs will be created by the people who will be running the systems to provide this gas? Every single job will be lawyers, accountants, administrators, engineers, everybody will be. By the time you run that gas system all over Nigeria, that is when you talk about lifting people out of poverty. That is job creation. Job creation is not giving 5,000 naira stipend that the vice president goes to go and be giving. Job creation means giving people real jobs to do. If we have rail lines, even if we start with every state capital in Nigeria connected on the rail, funded by private sector money, do you know the number of young people that when they wake up in the morning, they are going to be train drivers, they are going to be train engineers, they are accountants, engineers, administrators in those places, even cleaners of the stations will get job. You understand? You think about people who are the ticket sellers, customer service, all over the nation, because Nigerians will be going by trains, paying their money. But the government is sitting on those things, like you rightly say, 68 items on the exclusive list of the Constitution. The federal government is sitting on them. And the federal government cannot unlock value from these things because the federal government does not have the money to develop these things. So why can't the federal government just move away so that the private sector takes this thing and then pushes it forward? So when we say political will, people just lost power, central power, control. This kind of military thinking that we have to have a command and control center. That's not the economy of today. The economy of today is that a government is only checking that everything is done right through regulation. But the government is not an active player in the economy. The trains should be built and run by train companies, by investors, who are ready to carry 200 million people about and create the jobs. So this is the kind of thing I'm saying. It has to be political way. It could also be that it's just intentional. I want to suffer people, but the question would be why? Why do you want people to suffer?
Interesting question there, Mr. Nick Agule, public affairs analyst, joining us live from the UK. We thank you very much for joining us on The Breakfast this morning.
Thank you so very much. We pray for Nigeria. My last message to Nigerians is that the INEC has opened the register for people who have not yet registered as voters, people who have registered and want to move their polling units, and people who want to trace their voter's card where it is. Please, let us go there and get our voter's card ready. The voter's card remains the only legitimate, legal, constitutional, and less risky, less bloody way to get a government of our choice. Analyzing these issues on social media and on TV and all of that is good, but the real thing is when all of us come out to vote. The government, the politicians are afraid of our votes. That's why they are now trying to tinker with the electoral bill about electronic voting and all of that. It's because they are afraid of our votes. Our votes are our weapons. You don't throw away your weapon when your opponent is afraid of that weapon. So every Nigerian must step out and get our voters' card. 15 million people voted the last time. Let's get 60 million, 70, 80 million people vote in 2023 and get a government of our choice.
All right.
Thank you again, Mr. Nick Agule.
Thanks for
speaking with us.
And have a nice day.
Yeah. I think I just thought it was important to, you know, throw that point out there, you know, because we've had these conversations multiple times, different analysts, different guests, you know, and it's gone on for years. You know, even back on radio, we've had these same conversations. It cannot be that there's nobody on the president's team or on the vice president's team in National Assembly who doesn't know these things. And so when they keep giving excuses, the Senate president speaking like an analyst. How are you speaking like an analyst? You're not Nick Agule. You are the Senate president of Nigeria. You know the things that you need to do if we need to move forward as a country. But anyway, that's where we wrap things up this morning. Thank you very much for joining us. If you missed out on any of our conversations, remember where to find them. At Plus TV Africa on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, and same with our YouTube channel at Plus TV Africa and Plus TV Africa Lifestyle.
Yes, Plus TV Africa Lifestyle. We're also on social media and on YouTube with that same handle. My name is Aneta Felix. Thank you for joining us this beautiful Monday morning. Have a great rest of the week.